Okay, so a little bit of background about the Atlas orthogonal procedure. We do a Grostic-based program. For all of you that know Dr. Grostic or have known of Dr. Grostic, we go ahead and we use a model of three-dimensional misalignments. We do a lateral, a frontal, and a horizontal x-ray. From that, we derive work factors that give us the appropriate vector to go ahead and adjust the atlas. Up, as you'll see there, that is Dr. Sweat. That is our Atlas orthogonal percussion instrument. As I say, I've been using that instrument for over 30 years now. I did start out with hand adjusting. My first mentor was Dr. E.L. Crowder. You're lucky enough to have one great mentor in your life. I had two amazing mentors. So that's the Atlas orthogonal procedures. And orthogonal means to be at right angles. We look to get the atlas orthogonal or perpendicular to the head and the neck. We believe that the three rings, we call them the three rings, foramen magnum, ring of the atlas, and C2, are the key area of not only misalignment, but various types of neuropathological processes. You'll see shortly. And we look at the body in our Cartesian system, three-dimensional. We do our lateral x-ray, we do our frontal x-ray, we do our horizontal x-ray, and this is the basis of what we use to go ahead and derive a vector to go ahead and adjust the patient's atlas. Obviously, we've all seen this. When we're out of adjustment, you render a short leg. It's a postural distortion. We do a leg check supine. Obviously, we do pre and post leg balance checking. We do something called scanning palpation. Scanning palpation is where you use our hands to palpate the paraspinal muscles, starting from the occipital base down to the cervical spine and cervical thoracic junction. We did a study back in the 90s and did an intra-reliability with medical doctors and dentists, and they all said they felt what we felt before and after the adjustment. So it's a pretty accurate system. Dr. Grostic stated that 50% of the adjustment is what happens above. We're going to be exploring above today. Okay, we talk about and are very critical about patient placement, mastoid support. If you go ahead and have that patient in a wrong posture, wrong position on the head support, you will not achieve the correction you're looking for. These are various different positioning or setups for various different types of patterns. We have a series of different patterns that we measure through the x-rays, and that derives us the information on how to adjust that pattern. Some of you might have heard about a kink pattern or against the angles or contralateral. We work with those pretty explicitly. And there's numerous types of pattern that derive different types of setups. And an improper setup, we've done DMX studies and looked at patients in their movement up and down, laying on a side posture table, headpiece going up and down. And we've seen some amazing things about how headpiece too high, headpiece too low can completely blow the pre-stress of that setup and limit the outcome of what you and the patient will be looking for. We're pretty critical about that. Again, that's the instrument. Okay, let's get into the fun stuff. It's kind of hard to hit the head without affecting the neck. And it really is. This is where I mentioned earlier, if the scientific world, the medical world knew what we're capable of, we'd all choke. There would never be enough of us. And we're on our way there. I think we're getting there little by little. Different types of trauma. Different types of trauma. Take a look at this. This is what the world has become. So these are various types of traumas. It's okay, don't worry about it. Y'all get the idea? This is what we deal with in practice. This is what we do. You don't have to worry about it. No, okay. People are crazy today. We're adjusting spines that our forefathers didn't. I'm serious. Boom. You can't make this up. They didn't have cars that did 150. They didn't have people texting. Yeah. See it? That's become our world. That's become our world. Got it? Okay. All right, I'm going to talk about imaging. There's a problem. There are too many people not taking imaging sufficiently after trauma. According to this study, there was about 4 to 30% of injuries were missed because someone didn't take the right picture. And due to that, 29% of these patients went on to have permanent nerve damage and sequela because someone didn't do the right job. We're here to make sure you all do the right job. When a patient has a trauma, you got to get imaging. Don't speculate, don't feel, as I'll show you shortly, it's not good enough. This is a patient that a chiropractor from Midwest sent me the x-ray and said, just as the patient wants to go back to playing football, what do you think? I said, I can't tell you unless you show me the x-ray, and he shows me this. I said, send me a flexion x-ray, multiple levels of listhesis. I said, tell him to go play the violin or baseball. Football's not his game. No, seriously. We're here to not only show the problem, we're here to go ahead and help make sure that the patient doesn't do something that they're unaware of can potentially hurt them adversely. That's a neck accident waiting to happen. This one was funny. I get a phone call from a chiropractor and he goes, hey doc, can you tell me what you think of this x-ray? And I said, did you adjust this guy yet? He goes, yeah. I go, how'd he do? He goes, he got real inflamed. I said, he's got a C1 fracture. I mean, what are you doing, man? Got to pay attention. Happens all the time. This is the cool stuff about what I do. I get to do dynamic imaging. I do DMX and I do moving MRIs. This is the same person on the left that's on the right. Look at how those discs radially expand from flexion to extension. They're causing cord compression, various other problems. Can't appreciate that unless you go ahead and have these types of imaging studies to see. Why is it so important? This is out of an orthopedic journal, a radiology journal. They asked a bunch of radiologists to opine on what they see in this lung field. Yep, 83% of the radiologists missed the fact it was a gorilla in the lung field. So the problem here is, no disrespect to radiologists, the problem is if you're always looking for the elephant in a room, you might miss the gorilla. That's why it's up to us to become great at imaging. That's why you're in this college, because you've got a great imaging program here. This is the Holy Grail. You take a lateral x-ray and see any of these findings, you have to be suspicious of there being possible instability. Go ahead at the least, take a flexion x-ray and see if what that shows gets any worse. And if it does, you've got to go into a completely different mode of treatment. You can't go in there and do traction and hard mobilization. You're going to get yourself in trouble. These are the static stabilizing ligaments and membranous structures. Y'all are in school here. You all would know them. And yes, they do rupture. They do tear. They do disrupt. Those are the craniocervical junction ligaments. You got the ALARs, transverse ligament, accessory ligaments. These are all the things that are our purveyance. So here's an example of, I did an MRI on this gal. She suffered for 14 years. She had complete disruption of the tectorial membrane. You'll see behind the dens. She was just all torn up. On the left is what a normal ALAR ligament should look like. On the right is what they look like when they're scarred. Ligaments on MRI are black when they're healthy, and they enhance or whiten when they're scarred or damaged. Transverse ligament, left is normal, right is disrupted. Left is normal, right is disrupted. Cord distortion. I'm an upper cervical practitioner and didn't realize that there is an intracranial dentate ligament. Y'all know what the dentate ligaments are, right? Okay. What's the implication of that? Look at where the hell that thing is. It's by the 11th cranial nerve, the vertebral artery. It is by a whole slew of things that feed nerve and vascular supply to the brainstem. That's why, as upper cervical practitioners, or any upper cervical adjustment, can have such far-reaching effects on a patient's wellness. So here's our typical pre-x-ray. There's our typical post-x-ray. That's what we do, pre and post. This is a patient with Parkinson's. That was him before. That was him after. Look at the distortion in the spinal cord on the left before we corrected him. That is a patient with Parkinson's. I'm saddened that Dr. Grostick is in here to this day. He had a hypothesis that when the atlas misaligns more than 3/4 degree, that it'll shift the cord to the side of the misalignment. That guy was 100%, 1,000% correct. That image validates the fact of what his hypothesis was. It is no longer a hypothesis. Here's rotation at C1. Here's the cord distorted and twisted on that patient. Y'all see there is an atlas going up the occipital condyle. You've got the dens in the middle. There's the atlas going up the right occipital condyle. That's C1. That's C2. That's what we adjust. Now, you can't see this dimension on an x-ray. You can see rotation, you can measure rotation on a horizontal x-ray, but you can't see that disrelationship of C1, C2 to this degree. And here's what I mean. That's an AP open mouth on a gal that suffered for 26 years, an occupational therapist. On the right, that was her C2. So somewhere there's a disconnect between that x-ray and that MRI. I adjusted her using the MRI as an image and measured the misalignment. That's a coronal. Can't deny that. Left is pre, right is post. For 24 years, she suffered terribly. She had 5 full days after that first correction of no headache and no dysfunction. She's been doing great, actually, now. Here's why you can't rely on palpation alone. Look at where the sinus is. Look at the body. Over 22 to 24% of C2s are malformed. So if you're looking on an x-ray even, and you think the C2 sinus is neutral, it might not be. Could be a faulty roadmap. There's a CT. Faulty roadmap. Here's another one. So that's why come these types of advanced imaging studies are really critical. This is a study my colleagues and I did back in 2010. Many of you might have read about it. I found that there's low-lying cerebellar tonsils in people involved in head and neck trauma like whiplash. 4 times more prevalent in whiplash than in non-trauma. We went through 1,200 cases, 600 non-trauma, 600 trauma. And when we scanned the trauma group in an upright environment, in a gravity environment, it was 2.5 times more sensitive at finding the tonsillar ectopia. That's the difference. So in a non-trauma group, laying down MRI and upright MRI are fairly similar. When you sit them up, we're almost twice as much. That's why I image patients in an upright MRI. So what we found is, we found the tonsillar ectopia in 1 in 4 trauma patients versus 1 in 18. And it's obvious that scanning people on an upright MRI is more sensitive to finding that problem. Most MRIs or radiologists will look at the sagittal MR to look for low-lying cerebellar tonsils. This is that patient going from right to left. Until we look at the coronal, same patient, that's how far down those tonsils are. That's the axial, same patient. So we say if it quacks like a duck, it's a duck. If the patient has intracranial pressure, headaches, nausea, dizziness, facial pain, tinnitus, and they come back with an MRI that says normal, they're not imaging that area properly. And about 85 to 90% of MRIs done today of the cervical spine do not include a horizontal or a coronal view. They do a sagittal view of the neck, and then from C2 disc down, they do an axial, so the most important part of the whole spinal axis, they're not even imaging. Here's another one. That gal suffered for 14 years. That is one hell of a cork stopper. Now, can we help it? Yes, we can. I've adjusted hundreds of patients and have done pre and post MRIs of CSF flow. The left is before and the right is after. That is the low-lying cerebellar tonsils coming down through the foramen magnum. Where is this thing? On the left. Here we go, right there if you can see, and then on the right, it migrated up enough to make enough room for that fluid to move, and that patient did amazing. These are the symptoms. They are vast. They are vast. I encourage you all, if you want, to take a picture of that, because low-lying cerebellar tonsils, being that most imaging is not looking for them, most of your patients or a high percentage of the patients might have an ectopia. And they have a constellation of symptoms that are pretty robust. So if you're getting a normal MRI, and these patients have this list of symptoms, then the MRI wasn't done right. Wasn't done right. Craniocervical syndrome. This is what I deal with every day. This is what we deal with as chiropractors every day. Pretty much every darn headache known to man, other than a space-occupying lesion or a tumor, is going to be coming right from the upper cervical area. And if that's not enough, pretty much all different types of neck pain and headaches. How's that? Drop attacks? Anybody here ever adjust upper cervically and help someone with a drop attack? We do them all the time. Call a vision, numbness and tingling into the legs and the feet. Yeah, an upper cervical misalignment can affect the lower limbs vastly. Okay, this is a pretty cool study. image on the right is a patient that a very famous opera singer who had a adjustment that didn't do well. And then they brought her up to us and we were able to image her and find out why. And then the image on the right is after the adjustment. See that cord on the right? It's bouncing violently up and down inside the neural canal. That's from aberrant spinal fluid flow. Image on the left, the spinal cord is not budging. She would have been put in a straitjacket. Her doctors kept telling her, there's nothing wrong. And she kept telling them, I feel like my heart's going to explode through my chest. You think that cord bouncing around like a ping pong ball inside the neural canal can create that type of sensation? Absolutely. Another one. Keep an eye, let's see if I can see that. So this is an axial view, we're right at the foramen magnum, the cord's in the center. And that's the vertebral artery right there. I want you to keep your eye on this. You're going to see the tonsils, the cord, and that artery, they're going to piston up and down and back and forth inside the neural canal. That vert is slapping the hell out of that brainstem. Depending on where that artery is relative to the brainstem nuclei can affect the clinical constellation of symptoms that patient has. And you can never see that in any other type of imaging. Yep. That's going inside hard bone with every heartbeat. CSF pumps with every cardiorespiratory cycle. Oh, man. So this is a Parkinson's patient. So my colleagues and I, we have really of the belief that neurodegenerative and neuroinflammatory diseases are more common than dissimilar. They just have different manifestations, like cancer. Cancer is cancer. It just manifests in different parts of the body. And we had a hypothesis of why it turned into Parkinson's in one patient and why it's MS in another patient and why it's ALS in another. So I want to draw your attention here if I can get my light. Right up over here, that's the midbrain. What's in the midbrain? Substantia nigra. I want you to keep your eyes right over here. You're going to see a violent tornado-like flow pattern that's going to be pounding the hell out of that midbrain where the substantia nigra is. It's literally pounding and flattening the midbrain. So this is such a gross example of it. I have a ton of these to a lesser degree where we see the CSF is going retrograde or backwards, and it's pulsing in and around where the substantia nigra is. And we believe that that is a piece of the puzzle of Parkinson's disease. How about this one, MS, another case. Once more, now keep your eye on the brainstem, the cerebellum, the brain, and keep an eye right where that third ventricle is. Similar scenario, different manifestation. Watch this. Watch the brain piston up and down, up and down, and look at that flow pattern right by the third ventricle coming through the foramen of Monroe. The upper cervical area is a choke point. It's an area where a voluminous amount of fluid has to come out of the base of the skull with every heartbeat. Anything that compromises that space can lead to a backup of intracranial pressure and aberrant flow patterns. On the left, this is a patient that went ahead and had a traumatic brain injury. She was suffering from intracranial pressure headache. She had to stop working for 4 years. Left is before and right is after the adjustment. So on the left, look at the cerebrum pulse. And on the right, that's a happy brain. That's what it should be. Spinal fluid should move smoothly around the brain to wash away neurotoxins and toxic solutes and infiltrates. And I can assure you, when you got a brain pulsing like that on the left, if that's not at the genesis of intracranial pressure headaches, I don't know what is. This guy was a day and a half away from pulling a trigger and blowing his brains out. He's a retired NFL player. Same thing with him. Watch the back of that brain pulse on the right. And to that point, look at the straight sinus. Where the hell's my pointer? The straight sinus, of course, on the left between the cerebellum and the cerebrum, that venous blood is going retrograde. It's going backwards. On the right, you see a normal flow pattern. Where do you think this guy said he was hurting? From the top of his head all the way down the back, he said he felt like someone was taking a hammer to him. After the adjustment, he felt better and that sensation resolved. So we're able to look at the brain in real time. It's literally in vivo studies of the brain. It is way cool. Take a look at this. This patient's got lower limb dysfunction, gait disturbances. Watch this. Watch how the cord, look at how there's stretch on the cord when that patient goes into flexion. You think cord stretch might create a problem? We see it all the time. She had MS, it was taken out of her lower limbs. Yep. Again, we do static flexion extension imaging, but you can't really see the extent of it until you look at it in a live study. This guy was a retired airline pilot. Every time he turned his head to the left, he said he would almost faint, pass out, and had an electric shock down his leg. Watch up here where the dens retroflexes and goes right into his brainstem. Watch. Boom. He also had a severe misalignment. I did a moving MRI on him looking down from the top. His vertebral artery on the left shut down dead when he returned to the right. That's where those drop attacks were coming from, or the sensation of drop attacks. Yeah? This gal was told she was a nut. Very important case. This is a broken neck. So these segments here are really adynamic. They're degenerative. Keep your eye on C4 right in here. She had a whiplash injury. Look at how the segment translates anterior and posterior, and look at how that gap's open. That's a ligamentum flavum, capsular ligament, interspinous ligament is completely damaged. We were the only ones that were able to go ahead and prove that you had a problem. And to adjacent segment disease, when you fuse patients' necks, when you lock up two segments, you can see where all the load goes to the disc above. Okay, faulty plumbing. By the way, this was in, I don't know if it was Guyton's or one of the physiology books. They got an ectopia in there, and they're assuming that that's normal. Someone needs to contact them. This is a famous soccer player I treated who had to retire young. He should have never been playing. He had a full-blown Chiari 1. He kept getting hit in his head and should have never played. So here's what we got. This is a canal, obviously. The blue in the middle would be the cord. When you get an ectopia, you get an obstruction. This is what we're working with. We got a volume of fluid in the skull that's got to get through an opening that is real small. And anything that will impede that creates problems. So these are flow mapping studies, and so systole, CSF goes out of the cranial vault, and diastole draws back up. So that's what a normal flow pattern is. This is what happens when it's abnormal. You get what's called back jets. They literally can become turbulent as they get down to the upper cervical area, and they can turn around, and they can just jet right back up into the brainstem or in the brain. We see that all the time. This is what we affect when we adjust a patient. There's only four arteries feeding the brain. Carotids, and vertebrals. What does the vertebrals feed? The whole brainstem, pretty much a good portion, 60-70% or more of the brain. So when these people are malaligned, they're not getting the blood they need for that brain to stay healthy. That's a venous cast. Yep. When they're out of adjustment, all those systems are being affected from being out of adjustment. Mechanical compression of the jugular vein. Any of you here hear about the CCSVI's model of MS? Unfortunately, their model has come apart, but we think we have a little bit more robust model. So this is right out of their article. You got an atlas compressing the jugular vein. I went back and looked at 50 of the worst cases I have. Every neuroinflammatory and neurodegenerative brain disease known to man, I found either one jugular vein or two jugular veins compressed by the atlas mechanically. It's a problem that they look at, but they don't understand what can be done about it. There you go. That's true. It's true. That's it. Where that arrow is the atlas transverse. That's the jugular. That thing's being clamped down solid. There's another one. So what I did was I went inside the brain. The jugular there is on the left and right. I'm going to go down slice by slice. There's the anterior ring of the atlas. These are the condyles. There's the lateral masses. Go down slice by slice. There you go. There's the atlas transverse flattening out the jugular vein on the right, and it's patent on the left. There it goes again, completely flat, about the size of a pancake. If you don't get the jugular or venous blood out of the brain, the venous blood is what carries the tau inflammatory proteins, what they're all talking about with chronic traumatic encephalopathy. So if you get CSF obstructed and you get the venous blood obstructed, the brain's sitting in swill water. Literally, not healthy. There it is. By the way, this was posted on an MS, I treat the president of the MS Alliance in the United States. She posted this on her Facebook page. It had 86,000 hits in 36 hours. Yeah. People are interested to know. C1, C2 malrotation. Check this out. This could very well be the only live in vivo CINI showing a mechanically compressed jugular vein before an adjustment and showing it improved after. So let me orient you here. That's the jugular vein. That's the transverse process. There is nothing getting past that bone. And this is it after it's got a straight shot way down. Left is pre, right is post. So can we help decompress, mechanically compress jugular veins? You bet. You bet. And there's nothing that they have surgically that can do that. That's pretty cool stuff. And the most important part is the patients report feeling better. It's one thing to have an image, but if the patient says you feel better, then you know the image is reflective that you've done something good. Glymphatic system, y'all hear about the glymphatic system? Glymphatic system is that the anatomists always knew we had a lymphatic system, filter out toxins in the body, neck, armpit, groin. What they didn't know is, does the brain have a system to do that? And they found out, yeah, it does. And what they did was they put a chemical tracer in the CSF and found out that the CSF is not there to just cushion the brain and hold it up. It's there to wash the brain. This is the article about it, and it goes on to state that when you have disruption of the normal CSF circulation and turnover is believed to contribute to the development of many diseases, including neurodegenerative conditions such as Alzheimer's, ischemic and traumatic brain injury, neuroinflammatory conditions such as MS, and they included autism as well. Autism as well. So, does making that CSF move properly by keeping our upper cervical area in adjustment help the brain's health? You betcha. Real simple. Brain on the left is normal. Brain on the right is Alzheimer's. CSF is the miracle grow of the brain. If you impede its flow, you impede the health of the brain. Another observation. These were two young girls that were sent to me from South Africa. One was epilepsy. The other one had CP. So that's the epilepsy. That's the CP. Y'all see the common thread? They're both choked. Can't get a bit of spinal fluid past that area. That's C1, C2 on a CP case. Yeah, that is C2 on the right, twisted. And that is the epilepsy. So remember I mentioned earlier that I believe that there's more commonality and dissimilarity. I think that upper cervical misalignments can become the genesis of neuroinflammatory and neurodegenerative brain diseases. Don't go run and post on social media that Rosa said that. It'll get me arrested. All I'm saying is we're exploring this, and I'm looking at the end of the novel, and it's looking pretty good. So when we're done, we'll publish on it, and you guys can talk about it. But you got to realize these are identical, two different disorders with identical problems. I'm going to be working with a large group that does autism and all sorts of challenged children. They're opening up, actually, a world-class children's hospital. And we're being invited to be part of that hospital to scan and to treat. So that could be a pretty cool thing. It's all of us. It's all of us. Yep. Here's my hypothesis. If we go ahead, I'll show you in a moment. Let's take a look at that. That dens was anterior to the clivus. That was after the adjustment. We're doing it. We're doing it. There's the vertebral artery compressing and deforming that brainstem. This is really cool. This is a patient whose father is a chiropractor, wonderful guy. He's probably in practice over 60 years. He had a full-blown Chiari that failed. He would walk like Lurch. He would have to check the baby's bathwater with his tongue because he lost sensation of touch, pain, and temperature in his hands because of the spinocerebellar and spinothalamic tracts being affected by his misalignment. So that's the circle of Willis, obviously. This is the basal artery in the middle, and this is the right vertebral. The left vertebral is barely open. You can see a little cinching there. And this is called ectatic changes. So that portion of the circle of Willis was deficient of blood. And yeah, we're helping them above. We've always been looking down, but we're helping above. That is complete restoration of the normal blood flow, and he's doing real well. Doing real well. Misalignments. Remember, I'm going to show you a series of different disorders, similar observation. MS. At C2. Thought she jumped a facet. That's after the adjustment. So we do that scanning palpation thing, look at the paraspinal muscles, how they're kind of aberrant and spastic. That's what we look for after. We say it should be as soft as a baby's bottom when we're done. Parkinson's, pre, post. Autism. I'm not saying that that is the cause of autism. What I'm saying is that I want 50 MRIs of autistic children, and if I find that 50% of them have a misalignment of C1, C2, COC1, then we just have created the hypothesis or the basis of a mechanical model that could be part of the pieces of the puzzle of autism. We know that vaccinations are part of it and the gut problem, but what if we were able to show a mechanical problem? And that's where I'm working with this group back in New York who's having that children's hospital. I treat the CEO and his wife, and I showed him this picture, and he went ahead and said, oh my God, there's a mechanical problem possibly. I said, yep, get me those images, and we'll go ahead and take a look at them, and we can obviously do papers, and it should be a great study. Okay. MS, that's before the adjustment. It's a big old MS lesion. That's 4.5 months. Look at the gray matter here after the adjustment. Look at it there. If that isn't a definition or a demonstration of the glymphatic model, I don't know what is. The only thing that this patient did, there was no medication. Only thing this patient had was an upper cervical adjustment. Left is before. This is a day that I scanned him in October. So I have a imaging method that I've developed, and I have a adjusting method that I've also developed based on the MRI. I'm not going rogue. I still use x-rays for an assessment of an upper cervical misalignment. But as I showed you earlier, there are some cases where the MRI can show things that the x-ray can't. So this was a day, as I say, I go up there. I physically run the scan. I position the patient. I picked a set of sequences and put where the slices go. It's all part of a process that I've spent the last 19 years developing. It's been a long journey, but thankfully, it's easy today because we went through all the hard work 19 years ago. I had to develop, funny story. So I was introduced to the inventor of the MRI, Dr. Raymond Damadian, and he is the inventor of the upright MRI. So I had finished Dr. Croft's whiplash program back in the early 2000s, excuse me. And I was doing DMX studies. I have a DMX scanner in my office. And one day I was in court, and the defense attorney was saying to me, motion x-ray, motion x-ray, MRI is the gold standard. And under my breath I said, you son of a gun, I'm gonna figure out how to prove this on an MRI. So I called up out of nowhere, I called up an upright MRI facility, in fact, how I learned about upright MRI. I was at an International Whiplash Trauma Congress in Breckenridge, Colorado. I think it was 2004. Anyway, I was walking around the conference and someone from Phonar was out giving a pamphlet about their technology. Now remember I told you I came back from that court case thinking I'm gonna go ahead and figure out how to do this, prove it, in injuries on MRI. I got out of my car and I saw on top of my toolkit, I don't know how it got there, I saw the booklet on upright MRI technology. I opened it up and I said, oh my God, this might be the answer. My thoughts were, if I have a patient that we do a DMX where they go into flexion and you get a listhesis of 4-on-5, my idea was, let me put them in the upright MRI in the exact posture that the DMX showed the aberrant joint movement and see if I can see the damaged ligaments. And son of a gun, I did. So just so happens, the owner of that site, her father was the VP of sales of Phonar. So she said to me, this stuff is pretty cool what you do. And she goes, I'd like to get you to introduce you to the inventor of the MRI. So they arranged this meeting. I drive down to Long Island. I'm in a boardroom with all their VPs. And the owner of the center said, all right, Dr. Rosa, why don't you show Dr. Jamadian? I had a DMX showing a unilateral posterior arch fracture that didn't show up on CT or MRI. So I ran the loop and I showed him. And he kept saying, show me that again, show me that again. So he looked at me and he said, well, how can I be of help? And I said, the state of the art at that time in the early 2000s was really insufficient at looking at those small little stabilizing ligaments and membranous structures at the skull base. And I said, could you please help me develop methods of looking at alar ligaments, or probably about the thickness of a lead in a lead pencil in some cases? And he said, sure, why don't you bring a few patients down? So I did. The following week, I brought down 3 trauma cases, and I knew I was in trouble when I put the, we put the patients in the scanner, and at that point, all I ever did was refer for an MRI. I had no understanding of MRI, for the most part. And I remember the tech looked at me, and he goes, okay, doc, what do you want to image? I said, alar ligaments. And he looked at me and goes, what are they and where are they? True story. And then the inventor of the MRI, who is my dearest friend and colleague, and that guy talks me up like I walk on water. He is just so adamant about what we do. And he's not a radiologist, he's an internist. That's his background training. So he's pointing mid-cervical for the alar ligaments, and at that point and that point only, I realized I had to build the arc from scratch. I went in and spent a year and a half in the cadaver labs. I was cutting everybody up because I needed to know, where are these things? How do I scan them? How do I do? And I was honored to be invited to Albert Einstein Medical Center. And I was invited in by Dr. Todd Olson, who's an MD. He was the head of the anatomy department there and also the president of the Anatomical Society of America. And he graciously invited me and a colleague down to do dissection with some students. And what a great honor. He was also on the chiropractic board in New York State, so he's really chiropractic, supportive, and friendly. So he goes ahead and we walk in the room and he looks at all the med students and says, you guys want to learn about the spine? They're the ones you got to go to. So we spend many, many days going over, doing dissection, and all the med students would come over and say, and where are the dentate ligaments? And where can the atlas compress the vertebral artery? So it was a great honor. So just as a background, it took me a year and a half to perfect slicing the alar ligaments. So it was a very long journey to get to what you're seeing today, and it was an honorable journey. And had I not been a geek and had the opportunity to go ahead and come up with ideas in the middle of the night and then go ahead and call Dr. Jamadian up and say, hey, can you do this? Can you do this? Can you do this? And go, yeah, sure. So that moving MRI was based on an engineer that I showed the DMX to, and he said, doc, I think I can do that with the MRI. And he did. So it's been a really amazing journey and quite a blessing. So long story short, the one on the right is the day that I scanned him. That was just prior to the adjustment. So the left is the day of the adjustment. The right was 4.5 months later. Now check this out, another hypothesis. Arachnoid cysts, we see them all the time. I think that arachnoid cysts are coming or developing as a result of obstruction of the CSF. Yes, trauma can create a problem, but I think they're obstructed CSF is at the genesis of that. And why do I think that? Because on the left, he's got a big old cyst, and on the right, that cyst got smaller. And I've got dozens and dozens and dozens of cases showing those cysts getting smaller. So does it work all the time? No. Depends on how long the cyst has been there and how hard it's encapsulated. But I do believe that it is plausible that those cysts are being created or formed resulting from the CSF obstruction. Bilateral venous compression of the jugular vein by the atlas. This gentleman lost control of bowel, bladder, altered gait, sensitivity. After we treated him, he did amazing, and he still comes down to this day. He's from Canada. So, left is before, pre-adjustment. Right is after. The scan on the right was done in Canada by his neurologist. Left is the pre, look at C2. Look at the cord being torqued. There's your dentate ligament. That's your dentate ligament. On the right is after. That's his pre. Look at the paraspinal muscles. Again, that's what we feel for at scanning palpation before the adjustment. Look at it after. That's what we do, folks. So, that was the day of the first adjustment. That's after. Is there still some lesion in there? Yeah. Has some of it healed? Yeah. So lesions are like a scar. If you cut your finger with a knife and you don't cut too deep, the skin will knit, and when the scab falls off, you have new skin you never knew you had a cut. If you use a steak knife and you cut too deep, when the scab falls off, you will have mended skin, but you'll have a scar. So our hypothesis is that the ability of lesions to heal depends on how long they've been there, how bad they've gotten, and how bad the scarring of the tissue in the parenchyma has progressed. This is the holy grail, as far as I can see, in terms of the glymphatic system model. The one on the left, the one on the right, was done 4 weeks later. So this is a rugby player from Canada, MS, and he was diagnosed in January, about 7 years ago. Meds for about 2 months, stopped, had an MR done January, February, March, and April, progressively getting worse, as were his symptoms. And then ultimately, he stopped taking any medication and got to me in June, mid-June. The image on the right, this had to be a divine intervention because I didn't do the imaging on the right. That was done back in Canada. Look at the slice orientation. You can see the damn vessels almost identical. So the left, that's a cavity. That's literally a crevice inside the brain parenchyma. The right is post, left is pre, right is post. Left is pre, right is post. Now, he called up and said to my secretary, go read the MRI report. And the radiologist wrote an addendum when he saw the new one and said, they've all resolved, 4 weeks. Left is pre, right is post. 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 There is your mechanical compression of the jugular vein by C1. So there's a transverse. You see, when fluid moves, it should be black. So the jugular vein's being translated anteriorly. After the adjustment, that fluid's coming right out. Excuse me. Sorry, guys. So with that said, he called me up and he said, Doc, I need ammunition. I go, for what? Well, I'm going to my neurologist tomorrow. And I go, and? He goes, well, I want to show him this stuff because you helped me. I go, there's no way he's going to agree that what I did anything for you. He goes, what do you mean? I go, he's going to say it's spontaneous remission. And I said, okay. I said, well, more likely than not, if he says that, then you can ask him. And it's, I didn't put words in a patient's mouth. You can ask him and ask him then, how is it that around 15 minutes after the adjustment, you felt easing of some of the clinical constellation of symptoms that you had? And of course, he went to the neurologist the next day, and the neurologist said, oh, it's spontaneous remission. And then the patient said exactly what I said, and the neurologist said, got a point there. So did he start referring? Probably not, but nonetheless. So the moral of this story is, thank you. I'm good. Four weeks, you cannot remyelinate in 4 weeks, in my opinion. So I believe this is one of the most robust demonstrations of the glymphatic system model. The fact that what we see happening is that when patients with MS, they get an obstruction of CSF, you get a raise in intracranial pressure, you squeeze the brain when you have increased intracranial pressure. What does it do? Well, it'll squeeze the cortical veins around the outside of the circumference of the brain. There's your drainage system. It'll also squeeze the ventricles. When you put the ventricles under pressure, the CSF can leak out of the ventricular wall, and when CSF hits brain parenchyma, it's an unnatural fluid hitting it, so it will start to create an inflammatory response, an ischemia, and then ultimately, we believe that's where the lesions come from, part of the puzzle. So this is a clear example of the glymphatic model, because how else can you explain 4 weeks when he was distant away from any medication whatsoever? This is Jim McMahon. Some of you might have heard I've treated Jim McMahon. He still comes in once every 3 months or 4 months to get adjusted. Jim was on a front cover of Sports Illustrated about 6-7 years ago, suffering from early onset dementia. All that white in this frontal area, that's pooling of CSF. I see this all the time. And the rationale that I've been thinking about is that CSF comes out of the ventricle, third ventricle, down into the fourth ventricle, and out of the skull base. The frontal area is the area that's least hydrated or fluid movement. So when they're out of adjustment and you increased intracranial pressure, The place that's most likely going to be deficient in the movement of CSF is going to be the frontal lobe. What's the frontal lobe do? Cognition. What is dementia and Alzheimer's? Cognition. I think we have more increase of Alzheimer's and dementia, not because of genetics, because of trauma, because of upper cervical misalignments leading to these aberrant CSF flows, intracranial pressure. I think it's a whole constellation of things that are occurring. So that was Jim before, that was him after. And some of you might have heard, and by the way, you can see right down about mid-cervical there, he's got canal stenosis. So not only can the upper cervical area act as a choke point, but so can the mid-cervical area if you've got stenosis, spondylosis, you got a curve reversal. Anything that's going to narrow that canal can affect the inflow and outflow of the spinal fluid. And as you see, after the adjustment, his curve improved, and we open up the canal, and he describes it as a toilet flushing. I would have rather he picked a different term, but I'm okay with it. That was his C1 and C2. Yep, that C2 was twisted like a pretzel. So this is an example of the flow mapping that we talked about earlier. The cord would be in the middle here. That's the cord. And all those volcanic eruptions are the CSF turbulent flow padding. That's the back jetting. That was him before the adjustment. That was after. And that's why he said it felt like a toilet flush. And he did fairly quickly feel the benefits. We adjusted him on a Monday. By Saturday, we went out for dinner, and he was drinking beers and having a good old fun time. So top is pre, bottom is post. And I say, go where they're not going and do what they're not doing, because no one can do what all of you have the capacity to do, and I thank you all.
All right, let's give it up. Thank you, Dr. Scott Rosa. We have a couple minutes, so if we want to take some questions, anybody want to ask any questions real quick? You got your hand up.
Any questions? I'm in the upstate mountains of New York, the Catskill Mountains. For all of you that might be older here, I'm about 20 minutes away from the original Woodstock Rock Festival site. It's this weekend, and I was at the original one in 1969.
Unfortunately, they can't.
When I had hair. Yes, other questions?
What's your question? Commented a while back about a sonotonal wave in the axons.
Well, spinal fluid, when it pumps, it pumps in a wave. When your heart contracts during systole, that's when the CSF is compressed or squeezed out of the ventricles, and then it moves in a wave, and then it goes around the brain through the third ventricle into the fourth ventricle and out of the base of the canal.
Dr. Rosa, we got a question.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Rosa, I'm wondering how many facilities across the nation are capable of this technology and imaging?
Okay, so there are probably about over 160 upright MRIs around the United States at this time, unfortunately. So we pioneered the CSF flow software to history. It was actually sitting on a shelf collecting dust. And when I started noticing all these low-lying cerebellar tonsils one night, the engineer was up there with me. And I go, man, I wonder what that's doing to the CSF. And he said to me, Doc, Fonar started making a CSF flow software for Dr. Milrod at the Chiari Institute, and they never took interest in it. So it sat on a shelf collecting dust from 98 till, I think, 2004 or 5 is when we requested it. And then it took us about a year and a half to perfect that. But anyway, to your point, at this point, the CSF stuff is not FDA approved. I get to use it because I work out of the corporate centers. But that CSF flow stuff will start to become more available as more centers come up and more centers are interested in possibly getting involved with it.
Do you know of any facilities here in California that
No, unfortunately not at this time, but you never know. Something might happen in the near future, hopefully.
All right, what we're going to do is, if you have any more questions, we're going to go ahead and do that right afterwards with Dr. Rosa. But Dr. Rosa, thank you so much for your time.
Okay. Thank you all. Thank you.